Friends, hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed, hallelujah. The Lord be with you and also with you. Friends, good morning and welcome to our Sunday worship at home. We are so glad that you have joined us to celebrate on this fourth Sunday of Easter. And as you know, the fourth Sunday of Easter is always known as Good Shepherd Sunday, reminding us that Jesus is our Good Shepherd, cares for us, He nurtures us, and He protects us. But while we are still unable to celebrate worship together, let us be united in the Spirit of Christ with the church around the world as we celebrate in Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection. So I'm going to ask you once again to bow your heads as we open up in a word of prayer. And so, God of love, in trust we gather on this first day of the week, made holy by the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Strengthen our church community with peace during the uncertain times and deepen our solidarity with your church throughout the world. Fill our homes today with the spirit of the gospel and rekindle in us today the vision of your kingdom. May we who celebrate Christ's resurrection this day share in his eternal glory, and may we never forget the caring shepherd is always with us. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, we're going to begin our service by singing "To God Be the Glory." Sacrifice for your time, and it's just awesome to hear your voices. I know for me personally, it feels like I am at home just to hear those familiar voices. So thank you all for your hard work. Can I please ask Umar and Felicity if they will please do the synexis part with me? Umar and Felicity. I will say the lines in blue, and if Umar and Felicity will respond with the lines in bold black. This morning we come to celebrate the Good Shepherd, so let us make a joyful noise to the Lord.
We will worship the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his.
We are his people, the sheep of his pasture.
Let us enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Let give thanks to him and praise his name. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Friends, as we move into a time of confession, we are reminded that every week, as we worship together, you and I have the opportunity to admit to ourselves, to each other, and to God that we do not always love as we are called. So in this time of confession, let us remember that Jesus is the Good Shepherd who cares for the flock with great patience and compassion, and is merciful and just, eager to offer grace and love. So let us pray first in silence. And so with that from our hearts, we pray the prayer of confession, and Felicity and Umar will pray the prayer on our behalf.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
So Almighty God, forgive all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon your sins and set you free from them, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep in eternal life, to Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And once again, Felicity and Umar will lead us in the collect set for Good Shepherd Sunday.
Good Shepherd, you are the gate that secures the sheepfold. Grant that all who hear your voice may know you who calls us each by name and follow where you lead. For you live and reign in the unity of the Blessed Trinity, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Friends, we now listen to the first reading that Alex Colts will read for us.
The first reading is taken from of the believers. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of the bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe. Many wonders and miraculous signs were done by them. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Gave to anyone as he had need. They continued to meet together in the temple. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. The favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We now take a moment to reflect on what we have heard. We now move on to our psalm there for this morning. And can I please ask Fenice and Lawrence van Grienen to do the psalm with me? I will do the lines in blue and Fenice and Lawrence will do the lines in bold black. And our psalm for this morning is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd.
Therefore can I lack nothing.
He will make me lie down in green pastures
and lead me beside still waters.
He will refresh my soul
and guide me in right pathways for his name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff comfort me.
You spread a table before me in the face of those who trouble me.
You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup will be full.
Surely your goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
If you can say that, Fenice and Lawrence.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
We now listen to our second reading that Ashton Joseph will read for us.
The second reading is taken from 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 19 to 25. God will bless you for this if you endure the pain of undeserved suffering, because you are conscious of his will. For what credit is there if you endure the beatings you deserve for having done wrong? But if you endure suffering, even when you have done right, God will bless you for it. It was to this that God called you, for Christ himself suffered for you and left you an example, so that you would follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no one ever heard a lie come from his lips. When he was insulted, he did not answer back with an insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but placed his hopes in God, the righteous judge. Christ himself carried our sins in his body to the cross, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. It is by his wounds that you have been healed. You are like sheep that had lost their way, but now you have been brought back to follow the shepherd and keeper of your souls. Hear the word of the Lord.
We now reflect on what we have heard through the reading. We now going to sing our gradual hymn that will be sung by Fenice van Grenen, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is."
Yeah.
the gospel reading that will be read by Imran Baron.
Listen to the good news as it is proclaimed in the gospel of the book of John, chapter 10, reading from verse 1 to 10.
Glory to Christ.
The good shepherd and his sheep. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. He goes on ahead of all of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never find a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers. But the sheep have not heard them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to them." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord. Can I please ask Lavan Vickley if you can please lead us in the Nicene Creed?
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. God of all the sheep, thank you for being with us today. Help us to take a look at our lives and our relationship to you. Bring us close, draw us in, and may your Holy Spirit strengthen us to be devoted to the teachings of your word, that through it we may hear your voice and follow it into eternal life. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I went on the internet this week just to read up to see how other churches are worshiping during the COVID-19 pandemic. And it was during my research that I came across a very interesting article that I think speaks very powerfully to our gospel reading of this morning. The article is entitled, "A Congregation That Spans the U.S. and Mexican Border," and it is written by Amy Frankholm. Now, this article is about a border church who worships in Friendship Park. And as I say, this border church is between the United States and Mexican border. Now, for years, Christians have gathered on a Sunday morning at the fence of Friendship Park to share worship and to share communion. Now, on the Mexican side, there is about 50 or more worship attendees, while on the U.S. side, there's only 10 people at a time. And the reason why there's only 10 people is because the Border Patrol only allows 10 people at a time to go into Friendship Park. But one of the reasons why the Mexican side has got so many attendees is because many of the Mexicans that was deported back from the United States back into Mexico, they come to the border church to experience a sense of connection across the border, because some of them still have children that live on the U.S. side. But what stood out for me, according to this article, this border church has survived every obstacle that the United States and the Mexican border have thrown at them. And I just want to take three examples that really stood out for me from this article. The first example is, if the Border Patrol wouldn't allow the two sides to come too close to each other, to hear each other's words, what they will do, they will call each other and they will conduct worship services over their cell phones, just standing 50 feet from each other. The second one is, now for communion, what they did, they shared sandwiches and wine as Holy Communion. But there's also times that the Border Patrol will not allow them to pass the bread and the wine through the fence. So what they will do when the Border Patrol doesn't allow this, they will practice what they call sacramental solidarity. In other words, they will serve the communion to each other side by side. And this is what we're going to do this morning, because this morning service also includes Holy Communion. And even though you and I are not together, but we will serve communion to each other side by side. The third example, friends, is that they replaced the fence with a concrete wall. But this didn't deter the worshippers from worshiping. And what they did, my friends, they couldn't see each other anymore, but they will still pass the peace pinky by pinky to the little holes that is in the new wall. And during the coronavirus outbreak, with Friendship Park Church being closed on the U.S. side, Border Church continued to meet just like us and many others via Zoom and Facebook Live. But reading this article has helped me in preparing for today's sermon. Now, the lectionary offers us a gospel reading that is packed with themes that one can preach on. In just 10 verses, John gives us so much that we can reflect on. And it is tempting to treat this part of John's gospel as if it is written in some secret code and it's our job to crack these secret codes. For example, we might ask, what exactly does a sheepfold represent? Does it represent heaven? Does it represent the church? Or does it represent our hearts? We may even ask, who are the thieves? Are they different from the strangers with the creepy voices? We might even ask ourselves, who are the gatekeepers? Is God the gatekeeper? Is the Holy Spirit the gatekeeper? Or is Jesus himself the gatekeeper? But then again, Jesus can't be the gatekeeper, because twice he says to us that he is the gate and that he is the shepherd. But it's also tempting to assume, when we read this passage, it's also tempting for us to assume that you and I are automatically the insiders. It is tempting, my friend, to think that you and I are never the sheep that listens to the stranger's voice, that we're never the sheep that follows the stranger's voice. It is tempting for us to think that we never resort to deceptive shortcuts instead of entering through the gate. It is tempting for us to never play the role of the thief in people's lives. And it's tempting for us to think that we are following the true shepherd when he ventures into new and risky terrain. But I think this passage, my friends, is not about trying to make us good. This passage is not about flattering us, but rather this passage is meant to reveal something of Jesus to us. That Jesus is the good shepherd who comforts us, as we heard from Psalm 23. That Jesus is the good shepherd who offers us guidance, who nurtures us, who gives us direction and gives us protection. And for me, when you read the gospel reading alongside the article by Amy about the little border church, it offers us a powerful revelation of who Jesus is. And I must say, when I read this article, I imagine these eager and loving hands reaching through these small holes in the concrete steel to make peace with one another. As I picture the insistent sharing of fellowship, of prayer, of song and bread and wine across the border, for me, the image of Jesus being the gatekeeper hits us full in the face. Because I think if Jesus has to be at that border church, Jesus would say to the border patrol, "I am not the wall. I am not a barrier. I am not an enclosure. I am not the dividing line. I am not that which separates, which isolates, which segregates and incarcerates." But Jesus will say to them, "I am the gate. I am the door. I am the opening." Now you see, friends, where that opening comes in. Through those small holes in that concrete wall, they pass the peace on to one another. Jesus would say to them, "I am the passageway, I am the way and the truth and the life." Jesus will say, "I am the place where freedom begins." But most of us don't associate gates with freedom, isn't it? When you and I think about gates, we think about locks, we think about bars, we think about alarms and enclosures. We imagine toddler gates, we think of prison gates, we think of gated communities. Because many people today live in gated communities because of the security and it makes them feel safe. The gates that you and I talk about in the 21st century is very different to the gates that Jesus speaks about. Because today we have gates that is remote control, we have gates that is equipped with surveillance, cameras, audio systems. Warren will know what I'm talking about. But Jesus is a different gate, friends. Jesus is a gate that opens out instead of closing in. Jesus is not a barrier. Jesus, my friends, is the hole in the gate, is a place of release, of movement, of spaciousness. And as I said before, Jesus is the gate of freedom. "I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be safe and will come in and go out and find pasture." Now, often for us, friends, a gate is supposed to keep certain people out, isn't it? People that don't belong. But when we read this morning's passage from John's Gospel, it is important for us to know that the metaphor of the gate is not one of exclusion. Because Jesus has never been about exclusion. Jesus' ministry was always about inclusion. It is not a license to think of ourselves as Jesus' true sheep and others as outsiders. Because if you and I think in this way, we become like the Pharisees who expel the blind man from the community. But the gate that John speaks about, my friends, is a gate that includes everybody. No sheep are left out. In fact, friends, if you go even a little deeper, this passage is not about the self-protective walls that you and I built around us and that we hide behind. But remember in our gospel reading, Jesus says he is the gate. You and I are not the gate. Gatekeeping is not our job, my friends. But Jesus does say to us, if you and I enter through the gate, he will offer us abundant life. So friends, for me, the story is also about life. Life that pushes across intimidating boundaries. Because remember, Jesus never promised us a life of roses. But with this life, friends, there's also the ups and downs and the challenges that you and I face. So Jesus says, friends, it is life that flourishes in risky places. It is life that perseveres amid suffering. In our reading that Ashton read for us this morning, Jesus says that you and I must follow the shepherd even when we are facing trials and tribulation, even when we are facing suffering. Life that never denies the real threat of thieves and strangers, and yet holds out the possibility of pasture, of nourishment, of comfort and rest. Jesus offers us a life, my friends, that will persevere, even, my friends, when you and I walk in the valley of the shadow of death. Even when we find ourselves in the valley of the shadow of death, even when we are mourning the loss of a loved one, Jesus can still offer us life. Life that reaches through any opening that it can find, no matter how small, no matter how fragile, no matter how weak, but it insists on generous self-giving. And so maybe the question, my friends, to ask about this passage is not trying to crack the secret codes about this passage, about who the sheep is, who the gate is. But maybe, friends, there's personal questions that you and I need to ask ourselves from this passage. For example, what is it in me or maybe in you that resists the open gate? We call ourselves Christians. We come to church regularly on a Sunday. But how many of us actually enters the open gate that Jesus offers us? Another question, my friends, is where in my life or your life am I walled off? Because many of us have built this wall, a wall around us, and we don't allow people to come in. But you know, when we build walls around us, we will actually end up all alone. But maybe, my friends, we also need to ask, where in my life am I close to change, opposed to movement, risk, freedom, and joy? Another question, which flock do I belong to and whose voice do I follow? A very important question, friends. What flock do I belong to and whose voice do I follow? Do you and I know the shepherd well enough to recognize the calling, friends, in our lives? Are you and I willing to leave the fold in order to find pasture? Or are we maybe too complacent, we are scared, we are suspicious, we are just too tired to pursue the abundant life that Jesus wants to offer to us? During the last few weeks, we had to face the questions, we had to face all these questions in the context of the coronavirus pandemic and the aftermath. None of us, my friends, have ever lived through an international shutdown. We have never seen a time where schools and churches and every types of businesses were closed. We have never had social distancing before with rules of 1 meter separation. But friends, in the midst of the disease and death that has invaded the world, Jesus speaks his promise into our hearts and into our life. He says, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. At the end of our article on the border church between the United States and the Mexican border, Amy quotes John Feinstein, who was one of the founding pastors in the church at Friendship Park. And Feinstein says, he shows up every Sunday to demonstrate the true nature of the border. And he says that where others see a place of crime, fear, death, and hopelessness, Feinstein says those that gather for worship and communion every week they see a place of encounter, a place of exchange, a place of friendship, and a place of fellowship. In other words, my friends, they make it their practice to see Jesus as the gate unlocked, wide open, and inviting. And I hope that over the last few weeks, while you and I have been meeting via online behind locked doors, I hope that you have seen this as an opportunity to encounter God, as an opportunity to encounter community, as an opportunity to count friendship. Because friends, no matter where we are, Jesus says to us, I am the gate, I am the opening. And friends, he promised us that freedom begins with him. And I think if Jesus had to speak to us today, he probably will say to us not to be too overwhelmed, not to be afraid, just to be calm. Because one day all of this will be over. We just have to trust him. So friends, I hope that as we go into the next few weeks, that you and I, friends, will have our eyes on Jesus and recognize Jesus not only as the good shepherd, but also as the gatekeeper who offers us freedom. I pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now take a moment to reflect on the sermon. We now move on to the prayers of the church that will be led by Sharon Thompson this morning.
Dear Lord, thank you for another day of life on earth and for the beautiful sunrise you give us each day. You are a wonderful God of grace and mercy. Prepare us for the coming week. Recharge our souls and renew our hope as we have entered into stage 4 of this lockdown. We pray for our church family, the extended family and friends, our community, that during this time we focus on you more. You travel through towns and villages, curing every disease and illness, and at your command, the sick were made well. We humbly ask that you come to our aid in the midst of this pandemic, where the world is in a state of depression. Peace and calm we find in you, Lord. We want to thank you for walking with us thus far. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for protecting us, for healing us, for blessing us, and for answering our prayers. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. Let your peace, which passes all understanding, continue to guide our hearts, minds, and souls. God has never lost a battle, and he is not about to lose one now. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Sharon. Friends, I sent out a message asking for prayer requests, but I didn't receive any prayer requests, so we're going to move on to the notices. The only notice that I have for this morning is that, as you've known, we were hoping to be back at church after the lockdown, or rather level 4, but unfortunately it seems that the churches will still be closed for some time, but I just pray that you will continue to pray and that you will just remain patient. And I just thank God if we at least can still meet in this manner. I ask the church wardens and the parish council that we do need to have a meeting so we can just discuss some of the matters concerning our church. But I will send out a notice during the week. Thank you. So let's now move to the peace. If you maybe can, if you're with your family, maybe just hold hands if you can. I know it's social distancing, but I'm sure we can hold hands with our family. So friends, Jesus, our good shepherd, calls each of us by name and invites us to share his peace that he may give us life to the full. And so friends, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Alleluia, alleluia. So please give one another the sign of the peace. And then we're going to move on to our communion hymn, Shout to the Lord, sung by Sharon, Ethel, Venice, Lenny, and family. Of this difficult time, this pandemic, You have still been so generous in your financial giving to the church. And so to say thank you to you this morning, I'm offering up a prayer to say thank you to you. So let us pray. God of love, we do give our thanks for the many ways in which we are able to build up our hearts through actions which are glad and generous. Thank you for each gift which is offered and for each one seeking to grow in generosity. Strengthen this congregation through these givers and these gifts, that together we might share good news with a fearful world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, as I said this morning, we're going to do Holy Communion, but we are experiencing Holy Communion in a new way today. Though physically separated from one another, we are still bound together as a family. So as members of the household of God, we now join virtually to share in Holy Communion. I'm sure that all of you have prepared your communion, your little table with your communion elements. I just ask that you will choose one member. If I hold up the bread, that you too hold up the bread. If I hold up the wine, that you too just hold up the wine as well. So let us pray. If you can please hold up the bread. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made, and for us it becomes the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Natalie, can I ask you to please lead the lines in bold black? Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. To your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, and for us it becomes the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
And this morning we will use the fourth Eucharistic prayer. Friends, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your loving Word to whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He loved and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you, and so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of the evil one and banish the darkness of sin and death. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. And now with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
And so, holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on the night that he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, this is my blood which is shed for you. And when you do this, you do it in memory of me. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his death and resurrection, we bring before you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church, gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. And so as Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing.
Bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, give us your peace. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us.
Friends, Jesus declares, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. And so draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith for thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, we will now share the bread together. If you are with a family, if you are alone, please just share the bread. But if you are with a family, please just communicate the wafer or the bread, whatever, to one another. So let us first do the bread. Friends, this is the body of Christ, the bread of life given for you. Amen. And we will now share the cup together. This is the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation, shed for you. I apologize, people, receive the wine, please. Consume the wine and the bread as well. But as we bring our service to a conclusion, let us give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is gracious. His mercy endures forever. And so Natalie and Mali, can I ask the Lajpal, or rather can I ask Basil and Glennis, if you can please do the following prayer for us? Basil and Glennis. Natalie, will you read it for us, please?
We thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out into the world in the power of your Spirit to love and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Can I ask Michael and Kyle Anderson if you can please read fast a prayer for Africa, Michael and Kyle?
In the season of pandemic, with anxiety skyrocketing, God bless Africa, protect our children, transform our leaders, heal our communities, restore our dignity, and give us peace.
Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and with all those whom you love and remain with you always. Amen. Friends, we will now sing our last hymn, Give Thanks, sung again by Ethel, Fenice, and Lenny and family.
Thank you.
is to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ, amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Friends, thank you once again for joining us for worship. Maybe if you can just let me know how you felt about having communion this morning. Did it feel strange? Did it feel different? Would you like us to continue with it until we are back in our beloved parish? You can unmute and please speak to me.
Yeah, I think it's a very good suggestion, Charmaine. I think we must continue with it.
Okay, thanks, Basil Peters. I think we're in agreement that we will continue with Holy Communion until we're back in our church. But friends, thank you. Have a blessed week. Love you all. Hello, Uncle Basil, Carlos, Auntie Julie. Awesome to have all of you. Thank you to the readers. Thank you for everybody who participated. It's always good to be with you.
Thank you. Hi.
Thank you.
Lovely message. Thank you.
Who's bringing lunch for me today? Love you all. Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you, choir. Bye-bye.
Warren, why didn't you unmute us when we were reading?
You can speak now.
Bye, all. I'm missing you.
Uncle Basil, we couldn't unmute you because we don't know who you are on the call. We don't see your name.
Yes.
Put your name there. Yeah, you need to put your names down, people, please, and at least we know.
Where do you do that? Where do you do
before
that?
Before you join the meeting, it asks you, would you want to join as who? And you put your name there.
Nah, yeah. I don't think it asks me. I can't see that.
Can I ask you? Can I ask you offline, Basil?
Coffee. Hello.
This is Warren Basil.
What is it, Linda?
All circumstances today would have been family Sunday. Eat coffee and cook sisters, ne? Yes, enjoy.
Hi, coffee.
It's beautiful. There's Auntie Julie.
Auntie Julie.
How are you, Mom?
How are you, Mrs. Coffee?
Hello, Mrs. Coffee!
Hello.
Uncle B, how are you, Uncle Basil Carl, sir?
Hello, Warren.
Hello, Warren.
And thanks for you. Good to see you.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Hello, Norma. Tony.
Hello. Hi, Coffee.
Say hello to Tony.
Hi, Ethel.
Hello, Ethel. Hi, hi.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
This is Coffee.
Hi. Hello. Now what?
No one.
Where's Mrs. Coffee? Still there, Sharon?
Hold on. Sorry.
Hello, Mrs. Coffee. How are you, Mrs. Coffee? How are you, Mrs. Coffee? Can you see me?
Can you see Warren?
Yes.
How are you doing?
Hey. She's pointing to you. Are you okay, Mom?
Are you good, Mrs. Coffee?
Are you
I'm
good?
Sure you're enjoying the lockdown because now your whole family is at home.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Keep well, Mrs. Coffee. And Uncle B.
Okay.
Auntie Felicity, whoever's listening.
Hi,
Mother,
B. Hi, Larry.
Thanks, Warren. Thank you, Warren.
Coffee, thank you,
Warren.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
It's
church.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to end the meeting. Uncle Cyril, I see you joined us. Thank you. I'm ending. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, bye. Bye-bye.